So good evening, everyone. Welcome to Radio Sophia. I am Kranti Nanduri, a doctoral student at IIM Calcutta and coordinator of Radio Sophia. I am very delighted to announce that Radio Sophia has successfully completed 1 year since the inception. And it is a great pleasure to have with us Professor Devi Vijay, who has kindly kickstarted the first ever talk on Radio Sophia in May last year. And after a year here, she is again with us today, along with Professor Vivek Nair, a dear former colleague of ours at IIM Calcutta, to deliver a talk on the topic, In the Name of Merit, Ethical Violence and Inequality at a Business School. This joint paper of theirs has recently been published in the Journal of Business Ethics, a top-ranking international journal listed in the FT50. And let me take a couple of minutes to introduce both of our speakers today. Professor Devi's work examines inequality, institutions, and collective action with a focus on healthcare. She has conducted a significant amount of research on the evolution of the community-based form for palliative care in Kerala. Some of her current research explores institutional processes through which inequality, precarity, and suffering are produced and experienced, vulnerability and solidarity as key registers of working lives and collective action, and also feminist methods besides others. She was a Fulbright Nehru postdoctoral research fellow at Columbia University, and she has also been a fellow of IIM Bangalore. She has widely published, and she has a lot of awards in her bag. And her recent paper with a very interesting title, Strangers at the Bedside, Subaltern Solidarities and New Form Institutionalization, co-authored with two others, won many awards at the Academy of Management 2020 conference. And now our other speaker, Dr. Vivek Nair, is an assistant professor at the India Institute of Technology, Delhi. He's a PhD in organizational behavior from Indian Institute of Management, Calcutta. His thesis was a qualitative study on the role of context in determining career choices of Indian managers. And his research has also been widely published. And his broader research interests include subjective career success across the lifespan, entrepreneurial careers, meritocracy, flexible work arrangements, etc. And Vivek holds a BTech degree from NIT Calicut and an MBA from IIM Bangalore. He has also earlier worked in the industry in various capacities. And Professor Vivek has also embarked on his successful academic journey, and he has has won the IIM Calcutta Best Doctoral Paper Award in 2021 and another paper titled Facade of Neoliberal Merit, co-authored with our other speaker, Professor Devi Vijay, has also won the Best Doctoral Student Paper Award in the Critical Management Studies Division at the Academy of Management. So without any further ado, let me welcome both the speakers.
Thank you so much, Kranti. That was a generous introduction. And also congratulations on finishing a year. I do remember this last year. I remember it was fantastic that you started this during the lockdown. I thought this was an experiment, but it's great to see that it's been a year. And congratulations to your team. Yeah, to all of you.
Thank you very much. So hi, Vivek.
Thank you so much. I didn't know so much. I don't know where you got that info also.
Right. So I think we can begin, and let me ask the first question. If you can both, if either of you or both can tell us a little bit about the context and motivation of your current study on merit in top Indian business schools.
Sure. So I think I'll probably start off and Devi ma'am can pitch in. It's almost once upon a time, long, long ago, we started this project. In 2015, just joined the PhD program. This was a term paper that we had done. And we were at that time looking at identity workspaces, kind of an enclosed sort of space where, which is a fairly, a place where things can really change. It can be a very different experience compared to wherever you're coming from, etc. So to some extent, we were also keen on understanding how the placement process affects students and things like that. So it is situated in an IIM, we call it ABC. And so essentially, so it started right then. And after that, subsequently, we've kept adding data to this project as early as even I think last year, and so it keeps so this project keeps growing in some senses, and but broadly when we initially tried to in our initial interviews, this idea of merit sort of kept coming up. That see, clearly at least seemed, I mean, right from the start, I think to some extent, there were clearly some haves and have nots, and there was some kind of a, this thing that we tried to explore in greater detail. And then we also did this anonymized qualitative survey, which I think was not often used, but was very useful for us at least, because the things that people don't usually say are able to write it down in an anonymous format. And that sort of really triggered then a whole bunch of other data collection, which then helped us, you know, piece together this piece on merit. So, yeah. Devi, would you like that?
Yeah, just as Vivek said, it evolved out of a term paper. We were looking at something very conventional in terms of identity workspaces. But over a period of time, merit was a recurring theme, and we felt that it needed a lot more contextualization. There's a lot of work that is currently going on across the world on merit. I think it also resonates with that, with a contemporary dissonance with what merit promises and what it delivers. And this was, so our readings were in parallel with our work in this context, and this dissonance was obviously there in our studies as well, in our study as well. And also the other thing that I just wanted to add was that there's obviously an inflection of merit, which I think everybody who's studying in Indian higher education knows, with caste in India. And this was something we couldn't ignore. Of course, there's plenty of writings on it. So I don't think in that sense, we're building on existing studies that are there. And just, so that's how this project evolved.
Thank you. Also, if you can just slightly more elaborate, what is your sample of the study? Who exactly have you interviewed, etc.?
Sure. I'll start off. So essentially, we started off with MBA students, and as I said initially, the placement process was fairly important. So we were trying to get first year, second years. Everybody around the placement process, we tried to get some placement reps, if I remember right, etc. Gender was a fairly important thing. So sampling was with the notion to, you know, and as caste became more and more of a important factor, and we can clearly see some of those themes emerging and around merit, etc., then that also became a fairly important vector on which we tried to sample. So sampling was purposive in that sense. So that is essentially that was our sample. Subsequently, again, you know, based on reviewer comments, etc., we also added. We'd done this anonymized qualitative survey. So that was the other data collection thing that we'd done, and finally, we had also collected, as I was talking about, perhaps last year or so. We collected interviews of MBA alumni as well. So this sort of helps. There's some distance that they get, and with that, that also helped a lot to sort of refine our findings, etc. So essentially, those three: so MBA student interviews, MBA alumni interviews, and the anonymized qualitative survey. These were all.
If I could also quickly add that there was also this poem by Divya, who's one of my students in class at the time that we were working on this paper. And she was very generous to share her, because we talked about caste in one of the classes. And then, you know, she wrote this poem in response to that class. And then she was generous enough to share it with us for our research, which was great. Now, this also ran into a little bit of kind of troubled waters with the reviewers, because one reviewer just did not like the idea of bringing in a poem and said this is a very unconventional data source. Thankfully, we had two really strong reviewers who said that, you know, and we came back and said that this is a very done practice with when we need testimony from somebody to use poetry as a form of testimony. And this was exactly what we were hoping to, you know, draw on for the poem, right? So, that was another data source which was very helpful for us. And so we do appreciate that Divya shared it with us.
Thank you. Ma'am, so basically now we are talking about merit. So what we would like to understand is how is merit understood in business schools by students and faculty? And there's a statement in your paper which says both privileged and disadvantaged actors embrace the fact-like status of merit. So is there any difference in how the so-called meritorious and non-meritorious perceive the merit or in any other senses?
Okay, let me start with this. I think the primary thing that we're trying to show, at least in the first part of the findings, et cetera, if you see, is that merit is embraced as a neoliberal ethic. And this much is actually largely accepted by both the disadvantaged and privileged, right? And when we tease out what exactly merit means, we sort of we talk about these three aspects, which are sort of merit as prudentialism. Prudentialism is sort of a person who's taking very rational, calculated decisions and manages risk very, very well. So this aspect that is one idea of merit. The other is being entrepreneurial, to adapt to external circumstances. You know, if you don't get placed here, if you're not suited here, then you go there. If you don't, not good. So constantly readapting oneself based on either the external market or et cetera. So that's entrepreneurialism, which is, there's some amount of resourcefulness, some amount of creativity, optimism that things will work out in the end and things like that. And the third part is, of course, merit being as individual responsibility. As being responsible for all the outcomes and the lack of almost any kind of structural explanation to anything that's happening to you, right? And this is also, so that's also a very key important facet of how people understand merit in the context. And these three are very associated with neoliberal sort of views. So we're calling merit as a neoliberal ethic with these three main characteristics that are equally accepted. Anything to add?
I would just leave it there. I would completely agree. Now, in the way that we read the paper, we read the way participants articulated merit. It was both. Indifferent, of course, we'll see the nuances. You see the nuances unfold as the paper goes on. But the articulations were fairly consistent in terms of this facticity of merit, right? So even if people recognize that there is a disadvantage, people, I think, do know what a disadvantage means. But even then, the notion of merit is so sacrosanct that you just keep aspiring for that meritorious status.
Okay, can you also a little bit tell us why you are choosing to call merit as a neoliberal ethic? It is just an ethic, right? Or has it always been there? Or what does it have to do with the neoliberalism per se?
And I'll probably try it first. So the idea that if you look at a normal, or at least if I look at some of the other institutes that I've been a part of, getting good grades is very very important to being meritorious or a good academic, a good student. And one of the things that we'll probably see in a business school would be how getting a DAISY, day one, whatever, placements is also a very important part of what a meritorious person, what counts as merit. They are smart ones, they are the polished ones, the sophisticated ones, etc. So there is clearly some of these attributes and you sort of see how they become, it's a whole bunch of things that they do one's supposed to be smart and do to get to some of these placements. And therefore this aspect of merit being sort of in some ways being equated to some kind of a job market value, I think is what makes it neoliberal to some extent.
If I could just add that, I think that what we're trying to problematize is the fact that merit is not an ahistorical, decontextualized attribute. That merit has had a historicity and it changes over time. And one of the more writings which is very close to our context is Ajanta Subramanian's fantastic work on caste of merit. I hope I'm getting the title right, but that's on engineering. And I feel like all of us in higher education, if we haven't got to it yet, that's a fantastic book to read because it tells us that, how the notion of merit has shifted over time. So we were thinking about the very idea of what merit is. For instance, under the colonial administration, it was these ideas of being proficient in law and literature, for instance, right? In the post-independence Nehruvian welfare state, there is a notion of infrastructure building, and engineering gains a certain kind of salience. So there is merit which is attributed to the engineering class. And in the post-1990s neoliberal regime that we are in, it is an emphasis on financial market. So even your engineers who are graduating from IITs, the aspiration is not as much engineering per se, but to get into financial markets, right? So I think that's one way we problematize this notion of merit. And then of course, what Vivek says, that neoliberal merit means this notion of individual competition, hyper competition at a certain level, and that individual competition is what is going to get you ahead in life. And then the way you make it up the market ladder is through this individual competition. This is very aligned with the neoliberal logic, right? Which is that it's not the welfare state recedes and it is individuals who can then rise, right? So how we look at it is through these technologies of self. Foucault's notion of technology of self. So how Veronica Gago, whom we don't refer to in this paper, but what she talks about is neoliberalism from below. So we're not looking at how neoliberalism is affected through, you know, regimes like or the government or World Bank or IMF, but we're looking at how neoliberal rationalities get enacted by individuals, right? And that merit is a very strong rationality for that, right? And it's very intertwined with neoliberalism in that sense. I hope that answers your question.
Yeah, it certainly does. Thank you. So then when we're talking about meritocracy, so it's just a system where merit is justified as rational, right? As a commonly accepted rational, or is there more to it?
It's that how you rise through the system. The system rewards you based on merit, right? The idea of merit, which is individual competence, talent, etc. So it's through this that you rise. Within the system, and the system rewards you for this certain, you know, kind of facticity of merit, right? Merit is an objective criteria, which is no longer now questioned. It's an ethic, which is not problematized. It's natural, right? And then your rewards accrue accordingly.
Okay. So then that brings me to actually one interesting statement, which you have made in the paper about Sandel's notion of meritocratic hubris. And it means the smug conviction of those who land on top that they deserve their fate, and those on the bottom deserve theirs too. So what interesting evidences did you find in your interviews in this regard in supporting this statement?
Essentially, again, I'll probably start off. It's essentially this idea that hubris is this absolute confidence that many in the privileged sections have, and again, because they feel that they are responsible for all the good that happened to them, and that invisibilization, which we also say, of social capital, cultural capital, one truly believes that they deserve all this higher salaries and all the things that they're getting without acknowledging the role of circumstances, things that aided them in this particular. And that's what we're trying to say. I mean, there were some quotes I think we have used in the paper which tried to say the fact that, you know, if you put us in any situation, we will crack it. And there's also there's a notion of cracking which we hopefully will develop further later. But the idea that because we are, you know, there was also this another quote where sort of says profs deserve the best, and which basically means they are the best. There's a subtle meaning that, you know, that they. Confidence, there's a lot of confidence that they are indeed the best, and without all that is their hard work, and not there's no structural explanation to how that comes about.
Yeah, I think Vivek's handled that.
Okay, I'll move on to the next question. Now that we've discussed the idea of merit and how it is understood largely, so in what ways, so your paper is mainly about ethical violence and how it is generated. So in what ways does this idea of merit lead to ethical violence in organizations, especially such as public educational institutions with affirmative action for disadvantaged castes or gender through different policies?
Can I take that?
Yes, please. Yeah.
Great. Okay. So ethical violence is something that we draw on Judith Butler's writing for this, right? And this is a fantastic work of her, of Judith Butler's, which, I mean, in the broader discussions on precarious lives, grievability, somewhere, for me at least, this was a hidden kind of discovery. Now, ethical violence is essentially saying that you use ethics. Now, this whole idea of merit is that there's something which is, it's an imaginary for justice, right, or fairness. And it's a fair system. Like, a lot of us endorse merit, saying it's fair and it's just. Now, what notions of ethical violence implies that you use as something which is held as ethical to condemn somebody, right? And this is, so one is merit, and we can elaborate on that. But, you know, similarly, for instance, citizenship, right? And you use the notion of citizenship as an ethical category to say that, oh, somebody is undocumented, or somebody is a forced migrant or a refugee, to stigmatize. Right? Or you can use it in the case of homophobia. So you say that there's a certain notion of ethics in society, which is religious or whatever moral other criteria, where you say that, and then you use that ethical criterion to condemn a certain group of people, right? So ethical violence is therefore not just about merit. It's a broader category which has been wonderfully theorized by Judith Butler, primarily around the questions of race and homophobia, for instance, in her writings. What we do is bring it to the question of merit. We tie it to how merit affects ethical violence. And we try to show how people use the notion of this sacrosanct, sacred notion of merit to condemn people and say that, oh, you are not good enough. You're not meant to be here. You don't deserve to be here. Or you're diluting quality, etc. And these are, you know, at some level, it should shock us, right? That how do we say something like this to anybody? Right? And then the whole answer is that you don't consider that person as a subject, right? You desubjectify that person based on this kind of ethical criterion. And it is through this desubjectification that then you can then affect violence, right? That you don't no longer consider this person worthy of being a subject, and then you can thereafter say whatever you want, and that doesn't register as violence. Which is why this is how it becomes an everyday phenomenon, right? That you can just do it in casual conversations, in your mess, in your cafeteria, in your meetings, your project meetings, whatever it is, you just flip it, right? And nobody's going to question it because it's so normalized. So I think that's the notion of ethical violence and how it gets tied to merit. Does that make sense?
Yeah, it sure does. Vivek, would you like to add something?
What we are largely saying is that prudentialism and entrepreneurialism and being responsible. So what we're saying is that availing reservations, for instance, gets counted as not being responsible, not taking full responsibility, taking advantage, taking the easier route. These are all some of the ways in which people talked about it, and that is how you're not being ethical to some extent. Is the the accusation somewhere?
Thanks for reminding me of that, Vivek. Because that's what I mean. We're not saying a blanket argument that merit. We actually try to show that these are the discursive practices through which people do it. Which is when you say that somebody's not being prudential enough, somebody's not being entrepreneurial enough to try harder. That's the whole argument, right? Give people the resources and let them bootstrap up themselves through this way, right? Pick themselves up. These are the articulations, right, that do this. And then you will be meritorious, but because you are bypassing this, you are not meritorious enough. So I think that is the element that the discourse that we're trying to problematize. So yeah, thanks for flagging that. It is through these mechanisms, through a prudentialism, entrepreneurialism, and responsabilization that, you know, ethical violence is enacted.
I'll just take one more question, and then we can leave the floor open for other questions. And also there's a lot of emphasis in your paper about silences organized around oppression. Right?
Yeah.
And so is there also resistance, and then how do you see this phenomena operating in business schools such as IMC, and why is it also important to talk about the silences?
I think the idea of silence for us is both lack no speech, but also distorted speech, right? So it's not just no speech. So which is important to say. So when there is some form of speech in this, it's for instance, a defense of the fact that, but I would like to try to be more meritorious, right? So it's not a critique of this whole idea of basis of merit itself, right? Of course, there is resistance, and I think our paper documents this. I feel that Divya's performance or reading out of the poem in class was an act of resistance. Obviously, all these very vocal articulations from alumni, when they've had sufficient time to graduate, and then they turn back and say, well, actually, what was going on was not right. I experienced something which was individual, and now that I know better. So we see a whole basis of resistance. However, the fact that there is silence means that what is considered privileged or dominant discourse prevails, right? So I think some of my colleagues in the public policy area who talk about caste in class may have something to add here. But in my experience, what we've seen is that even the people, if we talk about reservations in class, usually we do not. And then when we do talk about reservations, even the ones who speak for or against it are usually people who do not avail reservations. So it's like the speech belongs to the person who, already has something, which is of status of privilege. So that's the kind of silence that we're talking about. And the second part, just to add to this whole notion of resistance, is that, if you look at central universities and state universities, there's a lot more, political organization that goes on within campuses. So therefore, there's resistance. And also in, campuses, even within IITs, for instance, I think increasingly we read about, Ambedkar study circles, etc. We don't really have those. These are considered pristine spaces, right? Kranti, I'm referring to your initiative with the Rohit Vemula case, when you were condemned for trying to open up a conversation, right? And that's what we mean by silence, where you try to foreclose conversations prematurely. And of course, there are people who still show up, so it's none of these are therefore totalizing. You cannot have these totalized spaces. People still show up and express solidarity, but what prevails predominantly is the hegemonic discourse. So that's what we just wanted to surface.
Right. So if there is something else both of you would like to add to this discussion before we open to the floor, if I've missed out something very important.
Yeah. Just wanted to quickly add that, while this is, of course, and I'm, we've done this study with our students, very difficult to do something like this. And we're very grateful that we have the space to do this in IIM Calcutta. I think it gives us space to do this kind of a study and accept it in many ways, as we've seen in the last, across consistently. And there's a lot of solidarity among colleagues as well for something like this. But more importantly, I wanted to flag the fact that this is not just a business school phenomenon, although our study is contextualized around this. And while we were in pretty much the later stages of finalizing this manuscript, and in the sense that it was almost accepted, this was this Jadavpur incident, which went at least it was covered to a certain extent in newspapers, where you had a student condemn a faculty member on social media for and if you look at that quote, and it's there in the Wire, several newspapers covered it, and they used this exact mechanisms to condemn, which is you deem somebody as incompetent. And then you tell them that you're taking away, you're using vulnerability. That is, you are taking something which is not yours. It just tells you how this is a larger societal discourse and not something which is, of course, it's contextualized within a specific place in our study. But I think this is a larger societal discourse, which several people obviously already contest, but just to put that in on record, that we do think it's not confined to the boundaries of an institution in India.
Vivek, if there's something that you would like to add.
Yeah, so I think just one point there, I want to sort of quote Sandal on this. I think he tries to distinguish between injustice and humiliation, where he tries to say when there's some injustice that happens, then, there's somebody else who's committing this injustice on you, and then you hate that person, you can sort of pin it on that person, but humiliation sort of requires you to also believe in it. So you blame yourself also, and that pathologization sort of talk about, that's also a very key element to what makes it silence, in the sense that you also believe in something, there's something wrong, there's an internalization of that aspect, and so that's that aids the silence, the process of silence. So yeah, so that's something that I want.